Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Phil Crowley, and I'll be your waiter. I know, it is my honor and pleasure to welcome you to Musique Electronique. No, Eclectique, not electronique, Eclectique. Musique Eclectique, presented by Lake Avenue Chamber Orchestra and Chamber Ensembles. When I was asked to introduce the pieces for this afternoon's concert, I thought it would be a good idea to do some research. In the process of researching, I discovered a number of stories that I didn't anticipate, and also a few surprises that I think you will enjoy. So without further ado and without further delay, let me tell you about our first piece on the program. Now, when I say the words four seasons, what's the first thing that comes to your mind? Is it the hotel chain? It's all right if it's the hotel chain. It's all right. Frankly, that was what's what came into my mind. But for those of you who are more sophisticated than I, it wasn't the hotel chain. It was the very famous Concerto Grossi, or Grossos, by Antonio Vivaldi. Is it Grossos or Concerto Grossos or Concerto Grossi? I sometimes get very confused by plurali. But the Four Seasons by Antonio Vivaldi, who lived between 1678 and 1741, are perhaps his most famous compositions. Vivaldi actually helped to develop the emerging concerto grosso form into a widely accepted and followed idiom. A concerto grosso in Baroque music is basically an orchestra piece that features a small group of musicians and a big group of musicians. The small group is called the concertino, and that's the small group of musicians, and the big group, which is the rest of the orchestra, is called the ripieno, or the tutti, which means everybody, like tutti frutti. So much Italian, yes. Questo marroso, mia malicia sidra. Now, after all that, the concerto grosso we are about to hear is not one of the Four Seasons. It is Vivaldi's concerto for two cellos in G minor, RV 531. What does RV mean? RV, it stands for the Riom Verzeichnis, often abbreviated RV. It's the standard catalog of the music of Antonio Vivaldi, created by Danish musicologist Peter Riom. And the word Verzeichnis is the German word for catalog. He wrote so much music they had to catalog it. And there are other music indexes or catalogs out there. For instance, there's the Kerschel catalog for all of Mozart's works, compiled by Ludwig Ritter von Kerschel in the 1800s. And the Bach Werke Verzeichnis, or BWV for all of Bach's works, compiled by Wolfgang Schmieder, who lived in Freiburg until his death in November 1990. So he was a very old man. Actually, he wasn't a very old man, but he lived in the 20th century, and it's interesting because I was in Freiburg in 1979, and I could have knocked on his door and shook his hand. Oh, well, it's a missed opportunity. By the way, all this musicology that I'm giving you right now is the result of the graduate study I did at USC School of Music, and also the internet. So I just saved you a lot of money. You're welcome. But back to Vivaldi. I think it's time we actually heard some music. So here to start us off are our cellists, Matias Pachalian and Elizabeth Su, performing Vivaldi's Concerto for Two Cellos in G minor, RV 531. Thank you. Zoltán Kodály, who lived between 1882 and 1967, was a Hungarian composer, ethnomusicologist, music pedagogue, linguist, and philosopher. When he was 23, he visited some remote Hungarian villages to collect songs, recording them on phonograph cylinders. That's before all of us, all of our time. Shortly thereafter, he met another Hungarian composer, Béla Bartók, and introduced him to his methods of collecting folk songs. Folk songs became very important to both of these men and influenced their writing pretty much throughout their careers. Kodály also developed a method of teaching music to children, which is still in use today, and which I believe we here at Lake Avenue Church have used and may still be using. His methods included rhythm syllables, rhythm and movement, rhythm sequence and notation, a movable do solfège system, hand signs to correspond with the solfège syllables, melodic sequence, and use of the pentatonic scale as an introduction to the major scale, adding fa and ti after the child became comfortable with the five notes of the pentatonic scale. Stressing the importance of folk music, Kodály stated that each nation should create its own melodic sequences based on its own folk music. The duo for violin and cello, Opus 7, is a perfect cross-pollination of Hungarian folk materials and the formal structures of art music. Its opening pentatonic melody falls into the Dorian mode. That's a scale built on the second scale degree of our common major scale. While a contrasting theme, alternating melodic phrases and pizzicato accompaniment, sounds Aeolian, or centering around the sixth scale degree, what we identify as the pure minor scale. You will hear a lot of passing back and forth between violin and cello as they hold a conversation, as it were. Please enjoy the duo for violin and cello by Zoltán Kodály, played by Natalie Boberg and Micah Sanders. Thank you.
Thank you.
Natalie Boberg and Micah Sanders. Thank you. Our next piece is the March of the Toreadors by Bizet. The opera Carmen is a dramatic tale of love, jealousy, and tragedy. It tells the story of a hopeless soldier, Don Jose, who is seduced by Carmen, a fiery gypsy woman with an appetite for smuggling. At the beginning of the opera, Don Jose is almost ready to marry Micaela, the girl next door, when Carmen, that siren, that harlot, she throws a rose at his feet and whispers that she thinks he's pretty cute and that she is totally available. Don Jose, that weak-minded, naive sucker, falls all over himself in love with this Aldonza, and so begins a torrid affair between Carmen and Don Jose that can only end in tragedy. Yeah, and boy does it. Looking for love in all the wrong places. Yes, sir, that's what's going on here, folks. And who comes along but that handsome, dashing, egotistical bullfighter, Escamillo, the Toreador. Everybody loves him. Fawns over him, especially the women. Anyway, Escamillo sings the aria, Votre toast, je peux vous le rendre. Yeah, I know, it's in French. It all takes place in Spain, but the opera's in French. I mean, go figure. So Escamillo sings this aria about the drama of the bullfight and the fact that he knows that the ladies are all swooning over him in the stands. Oh, yeah, he thinks he's so great. Why doesn't he go jump in the ring and fight the bull, you know? Or get married, I mean, same thing, right? So eventually, Carmen grows tired of Don Jose, but Don Jose, he's irretrievably infatuated by Carmen. This is what happens, folks. It's the age-old story of jealousy, that green-eyed monster. By the way, I'm skipping over a lot of stuff here. It's a really long opera. Takes about as much time as a triple feature. Or for those of you who don't know what a triple feature is, or was, it's about as long as it takes to binge watch an entire season of Friends. How's that? Anyway, Escamillo, the bullfighter, remember him? Comes back on the scene and Carmen starts dating him. Don Jose flies into a jealous rage. Carmen laughs at him, big mistake. Don Jose pulls out a knife and stabs her. And because this is an opera, instead of bleeding and dying there immediately, what does Carmen do? She sings. And then she dies. But Escamillo, the Toreador, he's still being cheered and applauded by the crowd. Who knows what he's thinking? The end. So now, from the opera Carmen by Bizet, March of the Toreadors. Thank you. while we've got our full orchestra here, the next piece on our program is the Peer Gynt Suite No. 1 by Edvard Grieg. Now, Peer Gynt is a five-act play written in 1874 by the Norwegian playwright Henrik Ibsen. Now, Peer Gynt is a charming, arrogant, ne'er-do-well Norwegian peasant who impulsively abducts a bride from her wedding and then abandons her in order to travel the world on other adventures. And the play is really long. I know this because I actually saw a performance of Peer Gynt at the Pasadena Playhouse some years ago, and it was really long. But don't worry, Peer Gynt Suite No. 1 is not very long. It's just a small portion of the incidental music that Ibsen asked Grieg to write for the play. But it does give you a taste of the Norwegian spirit that Grieg infused into it. The four movements of the suite are Mourning, or Mourning Mood, Death of Osa, she was the Peer Gynt's mother in the play, Anitra's Dance, she's the daughter of a Bedouin chief, and she steals Peer Gynt's money after he attempts to seduce her, and In the Hall of the Mountain King. Who is the Mountain King? Well, he's a troll king that Peer Gynt apparently invents or makes up in a fantasy. So, Mourning Mood, Death of Osa, Anitra's Dance, and In the Hall of the Mountain King. Now, this type of music is also sometimes referred to as program music, or music that tells a story. And I think that many of you will probably recognize one or two melodies in this suite, particularly Mourning Mood and In the Hall of the Mountain King. These two pieces are often used as background music for various things like commercials or other things you may have seen on the big screen or on television, video games, who knows. So, ladies and gentlemen, Peer Gynt Suite No. 1 by Edvard Grieg. Thank you. I don't know if you all noticed who was playing the triangle during Anitra's dance, but it was our multi-talented bass trombonist, Mike Wessler. He also happens to be an astrophysicist. Wait till you see what he does next. Now, if I were to ask you, which American composer was the first American composer, to have a symphony performed by a leading orchestra, the first American composer to have an opera performed by the New York City Opera, and the first to have an opera performed on national television, what would you guess? Don't look up there. Aaron Copland? No. George Gershwin? No. Charles Ives? No. It was this guy, William Grant Still. Often referred to as the Dean of Afro-American Composers, William Grant Still is known primarily for his first symphony, Afro-American Symphony, written in 1930, which was, until 1950, the most widely performed symphony composed by an American. Still was also the first African-American to conduct a major American symphony orchestra. All the other conductors up to that point were from Europe. As I did my research on William Grant Still, I also came across a rather obscure fact that happened to pique my interest. After William was born in 1895 in Woodville, Mississippi, his father, who was a local band leader, died, and his mother moved with her son to Little Rock, Arkansas. She married another man, Charles Shepperson, who nurtured his stepson William's musical interests by taking him to operettas and buying recordings of classical music, which the boy greatly enjoyed. The two also attended a number of performances by musicians on tour. And his maternal grandmother, Anne Fambro, sang African-American spirituals to him. Now, this is an interesting thing that I noticed. His maternal grandmother's name was Anne Fambro. That's kind of an unusual name, Fambro. And she sang spirituals to her grandson. We have a man in our church who has sung to us in church many times. His name is Tom Fambro. That's right. Now, I don't know if there's any connection there, but it did ring a bell for me. And I'd like to think that there might be a connection, possibly a family connection between this great American composer and our friend Tom. It was just a thought. When we all get to heaven, wouldn't it be nice? Now, I also think it's not inappropriate to say a few words about our violinist, Natalie Boberg, who will be performing the next piece on our program. You may remember her performance of the Kodály earlier in the program, and also of Duane's wonderful arrangement of Ain't That Good News with the Lake Avenue Orchestra in our sanctuary a few years ago. Natalie made her professional debut with the Utah Symphony in 2018. And she plays regularly with chamber ensembles and as a soloist. She's performed with the New England Conservatory's Symphony Orchestra, Aspen Music Festival's Philharmonic Opera, Aspen Music Festival's Philharmonic Opera Orchestra and Baroque Ensemble, the three ensembles there in Aspen, and the American Youth Symphony, Young Musicians Foundation's debut orchestra, and on and on. Please welcome Natalie Boberg and Duane Funderburk as they perform William Grant Still's Suite in Three Movements for violin and piano. Thank you. Boy, I love that. Now, the orchestra is going to play a special piece. It is entitled Longing for the Spring Breeze, a Chinese folk song written by Tung Yushen in 1933. Tung Yushen was a Taiwanese Hakka musician who lived between 1906 to 1944. And he is regarded as the father of Taiwanese folk music, of Taiwanese folk songs. Now, this is really interesting, because I just recently heard a story from Cindy Simkovich, and I wonder if she's here today. Is she here? I don't know. Cindy's brother, Ernie Bear, Cindy's sister, Nancy Smith. Their father is Ernie Bear Sr. I heard this story recently here at church, a story that happened at Green Oak Ranch a few weeks ago at Lake Avenue's Memorial Weekend Retreat. Saturday mornings, there's a kind of a coffee hour in the middle of camp, and a young Chinese couple, Alex Chan and his wife, Lichi, who had just started attending Lake Avenue Church, showed up there. And Cindy's husband, Don, was having a conversation with them and asking how they came to Christ and so on. And Alex told him that they were from Taiwan and had come to the U.S. to study at Logos Seminary to become an ordained pastor. Don said, well, that's interesting. But you know, my father-in-law, Ernie Bear, was a missionary many years ago in Taiwan working with the Hakka people. Now, Ernie had been working with an unreached people group. The Hakka were known at that time to be very unresponsive to the gospel. There was even a book called The Hakka, the Unresponsive. They practiced a form of ancestor worship and just were not interested in Christianity at all. And at the beginning of his ministry among them, Ernie had all sorts of obstacles to overcome. And even after many years of working with the Hakka, he only saw two or three of them come to Christ. But one of the things that Ernie did during this time was to create a poster with 12 Bible verses on it in Hakka that summed up the gospel. Now, Hakka is not Mandarin. It is a completely different language. And Ernie wrote these verses out in such a way that they could be sung, each to a well-known Hakka tune. And by the way, it is entirely possible that one or more of these tunes would have been written by Tung Yushen, the father of Taiwanese folk songs, our composer today. You see, music was very important to the Hakka people, and this particular method must have struck a chord because, and now, fast forward back to Green Oak Ranch, when Don told Alex and his wife that Ernie had worked among the Hakka people, Alex said, I am Hakka. So Don says to his wife, hey, Cindy, this guy says he's Hakka. So Cindy comes over and things really get interesting. Alex tells Cindy that he knew about her father, Ernie Bear, but had never met him. So the following week, Cindy invites Alex over to Temple City to meet her dad, Ernie, who is now 98 years old. He'll be 99 in August. And at that meeting, Alex Chan, a Hakka from Taiwan, knelt next to 98-year-old Ernie Bear and said to him, Mr. Bear, I am the fruit of your labor. And he told Ernie that Hakka churches were now popping up all over, and there is now even a Hakka seminary in the city where Ernie first worked as a missionary. But I digress. Let's listen now to Longing for the Spring Breeze by Hakka composer Tung Yushen. Thank you. now, I am going to tell you about our next piece that you are about to hear. Libertango by Astor Piazzolla. Astor Piazzolla was a 20th century Argentine tango composer and bandoneon player of Italian descent. In 1925, Astor Piazzolla moved with his family to Greenwich Village, New York City, which in those days was a violent neighborhood inhabited by a volatile mixture of gangsters and hard-working immigrants. His parents worked long hours, and Piazzolla soon learned to take care of himself on the streets, despite having a limp. At home, he would listen to his father's records of the tango orchestras of Carlos Gardel and Julio De Caro, and was exposed to jazz and classical music, including Bach, from an early age. He began to play the bandoneon after his father spotted one in a New York pawn shop in 1929. What is a bandoneon? That is a bandoneon. It is a type of concertina. What is a concertina? It is a type of accordion. And what is an accordion? Well, it is that wonderful instrument that Elvin Rodriguez used to play right here in church when he wasn't playing the pipe organ. Well, it is very much like a bandoneon. Anyway, Astor Piazzolla had a very exciting life as a young man, playing the bandoneon with a number of tango orchestras. What is a tango orchestra? I'm glad you asked. A tango orchestra typically consists of bandoneons, violins, piano, and double bass, in addition to guitar and drums, accompanied by singers and dancers of the tango tradition. Anyway, Astor Piazzolla got better and better as a musician, and even studied formal music composition in Paris with Nadia Boulanger. And she told him, "Your tango music is very good. You should write more tango music." So he did. But he wanted to modernize it, to bring it up to date with elements of classical music and also jazz. Anyway, in 1973, he moved to Italy, where he began a series of recordings which would span the period of 5 years. The music publisher Aldo Pagani had offered Piazzolla a 15-year contract in Rome to record anything he could write. His famous album, Libertango, was recorded in Milan. There is much more to say about Astor Piazzolla. But instead of that, let us listen to his most famous tango, Libertango. Let's go. Thank you. Ennio Morricone just passed away in 2020 in Rome, Italy, the city of his birth. With more than 400 scores for cinema and television, as well as more than 100 classical works, Morricone is widely considered one of the most prolific and greatest film composers of all time. Among the films he has scored are Sergio Leone's spaghetti westerns, starring Clint Eastwood, Cinema Paradiso, La Cage aux Folles, The Untouchables, Bugsy, Once Upon a Time in America, The Mission, and The Hateful Eight. His score for The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly is one of the most recognizable and influential soundtracks in history. Gabriel's Oboe is the main theme for the 1986 film The Mission, with Robert De Niro, Jeremy Irons, and Liam Neeson. It has since been arranged and performed several times by artists such as cellist Yo-Yo Ma and a number of well-respected professional oboists. The theme has been called unforgettable and a celebrated oboe melody. The film The Mission is about a Jesuit priest, Father Gabriel, played by Jeremy Irons, who enters the Guarani lands in 18th century South America with the purpose of building a mission station and converting the natives to Christianity. He soon builds a mission where he is joined by Rodrigo Mendoza, played by Robert De Niro, a reformed slave trader seeking redemption. When a treaty transfers the land from Spain to Portugal, the Portuguese government wants to capture the natives for slave labor. Mendoza and Gabriel resolve to defend the mission, but disagree on how to accomplish the task. Mendoza says they should fight. Gabriel says they should pray. In the film, the oboe theme is most prominently used when Father Gabriel climbs to the top of a waterfall and starts playing his oboe when he first tries to make contact with the Guaranis. He aims to befriend the natives with his music so he can carry on his missionary work in the New World. The Guarani tribesmen, who have been stalking him from a distance, approach Gabriel for the first time, puzzled by the sounds of the unknown instrument. And one of the Guarani warriors, seeing that the stranger and his music are European, breaks the oboe and throws it down the waterfall into the water and stalks off. Father Gabriel does not react. However, and the remaining Guarani, who were captivated by the music, allow him to live and take him to their village. The theme, Gabriel's Oboe, is unforgettable. Let's find out why. Gabriel's Oboe from The Mission by Ennio Morricone.
Thank you.
Paul McCartney. Paul McCartney's awards include 8 Brit Awards, 18 Grammy Awards, 2 American Music Awards, 1 MTV Video Music Award, 1 MTV Europe Music Award, 1 Broadcast Film Critics Association Award, 1 Classical Brit Awards, and 2 UK's Q Awards. As a member of the Beatles, his songwriting partnership with John Lennon produced some of the most popular music in rock and roll history. In the United Kingdom, McCartney has been knighted and was made a member of the Most Excellent Order of the British Empire. In 2017, he was appointed to the Order of the Companions of Honor, CH, for services to music. In the United States, McCartney received the Library of Congress Gershwin Prize for Popular Song and Kennedy Center Honors in 2010. In May 2011, in Peru, he received the Grand Cross of the Order of the Sun, La Orden del Árbol de la Quina, for his environmental protection work, and the Medal of Honor from the National Library of Peru. On the 8th of September 2012 in France, McCartney was awarded the Legion of Honor for services to music by French President François Hollande at the Élysée Palace. Tomorrow, June 19th, 2023, he will be 81 years old. He was a Beatle, a solo artist. He founded the band Wings. He is in the Guinness Book of World Records as the most successful songwriter of all time. And he wrote the song When I'm 64, right around 1956, when he was about 14 or 15 years old. That was before the Beatles and before the Quarrymen. And now it gives me great pleasure to introduce to you, right here, Sir James Paul McCartney. That's what I would say if he were here. I think that's enough to say about Paul McCartney. Now, ladies and gentlemen, when I'm 64. Thank you. To be fair, George Martin, the fifth Beatle, wrote a lot of that. You know who George Martin was, right? Their producer and a very accomplished classical musician and arranger. And he wrote a lot of the string parts for the Beatles, including that one. And now, once upon a time, in a galaxy far, far away, well, actually in Modesto, California, there was a little boy named George Lucas. This little boy grew up to be George Lucas, the writer and director of Star Wars. As a young director with only one successful film under his belt, he was paid only $150,000 for Star Wars. However, and this is a pretty big however, he also negotiated all licensing and merchandising rights to the film. You know, the toys, games, action figures, that sort of thing. And from the licensing and merchandising of that film, that little Buck Rogers meets Spaghetti Westerns film, little George Lucas earned hundreds of millions of dollars. Who knew? Ah, but the music. Yes, the music. You hear that music and you are immediately transported to the planet Tatooine. The Ewoks, Chewbacca, C-3PO, R2-D2, Han Solo, Princess Leia, and Luke Skywalker. And Yoda. And why is that? Because the composer, John Williams, convinced George Lucas that it would be a good idea to let him write the music employing leitmotifs. Now, a leitmotif is a short, recurring musical phrase or theme associated with a particular person, place, or idea. So as you listen to the music, you immediately see in your mind's eye the character or idea that is connected with it. You hear Princess Leia's theme and you can see her. You hear the Death Star march and you can see the Death Star. Oh, there's Obi-Wan Kenobi. Oh yes, I recognize that theme. Right, that's the theme for the Force. Oh, and there's the theme for... And Luke Skywalker appears on the screen. That's what a leitmotif does. But John Williams wasn't the first to use this device. No. Wagner did it through all of his operas in the Ring cycle. Das Rheingold, Die Walküre. You know, that fat lady with the horns on the helmet who sings at the end of Mets baseball games. And Siegfried und Gotterdammerung. But I digress. I think it's actually better for us now if we would hear the music itself. Ladies and gentlemen, themes from Star Wars by John Williams.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes our concert. Thank you for coming. I hope you enjoyed the music, and I hope you enjoyed the stories. My name is Phil Crowley, and if you didn't enjoy the stories, my name is Duane Funderburk. Thank you. Good night.